Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Baha'i Faith, A Beginner's Guide, written by Moojan Momen and read by Miranda Nation. Introduction. In the brief course of its 150-year history, the Baha'i Faith has transformed itself from a little-known Middle Eastern religious movement into a fast-growing global religion. Now established in every country of the world, it is rapidly emerging out of obscurity to take its place alongside older and more established world religions. In the course of its history, the religion has grown and developed greatly in terms of its numerical strength, geographical spread, and community organization. The largest Baha'i communities are now in South Asia, Africa, Latin America, and, relative to the size of the population, in some of the islands of the Pacific. In these parts of the world, some villages and areas are more or less completely Baha'i. Here, the Baha'is have initiated educational, agricultural, and community development projects. The latest available official Baha'i statistics, 2006, state that there are more than 5 million Baha'is in the world, 2,112 indigenous tribes, races, and ethnic groups in the worldwide Baha'i community, thousands of places all over the world where there are organized Baha'i communities with elected local councils, local spiritual assemblies, and 179 national elected bodies, national spiritual assemblies. This book is intended to be a beginner's guide to the history and teachings of the Baha'i Faith for those who know very little about it. Many people think of religion as an activity that is carried out in a church, a mosque, a synagogue, or a temple. It comes into the way that we relate to other people, and of course plays a prominent role at the important events in our lives, births, marriages, and deaths. But for most people, even those who consider themselves religious, most of the time religion has no impact on any other part of their lives or on the society in which they live. If you want to understand the Baha'i Faith, however, you need to think differently about religion. The scope of the Baha'i Faith is much wider than this. In the Baha'i scriptures, as well as the theology and personal ethics that you would expect to find in a religious scripture, there are teachings on subjects such as social ethics, race issues, feminist issues, economics, global government, and legal matters. Indeed, it could be said that there are few areas of human life, at the individual, social, or global levels, about which the Baha'i Faith does not have something to say. It is not that there are specific policies and detailed regulations on these areas, but rather there are general principles upon which policies can be formulated in response to specific situations. If we imagine our life as a room, then for most people, as they view the room of their life, there is one part of the room that is concerned with their family, a part of the room that is concerned with their friends and social acquaintances, a part that is concerned with their job, and, if they are religious, a part that is concerned with religion. But the Baha'i view of religion is not that it should be a separate compartment of our lives, but rather that it should affect every part of our lives. In our analogy, as we look at the room of our life, religion should be the glasses through which we look. It should affect everything we see. Those who have studied the Baha'i Faith have noted that its teachings are very much in tune with the concerns of the present day. Its social teachings include such principles as the equality of men and women and the need for world peace. In emphasizing its social teachings, however, there has been a tendency in writing about the Baha'i Faith to reduce the significance of its spiritual and mystical aspects. And yet, however advanced the social teachings may have been when they were first given by the central figures of the Baha'i Faith decades ago, the modern world has, to a large extent, caught up with them. It is the spiritual and mystical teachings that may now be the aspect of the Baha'i Faith that is of most interest to those who come across it for the first time. It is for this reason that this book is presented in a way that is different from other introductory books on the Baha'i Faith. The book opens with, and therefore emphasizes, the spiritual aspect of Baha'i teaching. Partly because of its belief in the fundamental oneness of religion, some have called the Baha'i Faith an eclectic or syncretic religion, one that gathers together the best aspects of the other religions. Since Baha'is believe that all religion emanates from the same spiritual source, they also consider it inevitable that all religions, including the Baha'i Faith, will, to some extent, contain echoes of each other. In this book, however, I hope to show that the Baha'i Faith also has its own teachings that are in many respects new and innovative. Since the names of the central figures of the Baha'i Faith will crop up frequently, I will introduce them briefly here. More historical details can be found in Chapter 8. The Baha'i Faith began 150 years ago in Iran, Persia. It had its origins in the religious teachings of a young Iranian merchant named the Bab. His movement threw Iran into turmoil between 1844 and 1853. Out of this turmoil emerged the Baha'i Faith, which was founded by Baha'u'llah, an Iranian nobleman who was at first imprisoned for his support for the Bab. He then went, in 1853, into the first of a series of exiles that culminated in his arrival in 1868 in Akka, which was then a prison city in the Ottoman Turkish Empire. Baha'u'llah remained in Akka and its vicinity, elaborating the teachings of his religion, until his death in 1892. Baha'u'llah appointed his son, Abdul Baha, as the leader of the Baha'i community and the authorized interpreter of his teachings. After he was freed in 1909 from the restrictions imposed upon him by his imprisonment and exile, Abdul Baha travelled to Egypt, Europe, and North America, helping to make a firm foundation for the Baha'i Faith in those regions. When Abdul Baha died in 1921, he appointed his grandson, Shori Effendi, as the next leader of the Baha'i Faith and the authorized interpreter of the Baha'i teachings. Shori Effendi is often referred to by his title, the Guardian of the Baha'i Faith. He died in 1957. In 1963, the first international election was held for the Universal House of Justice, which is now the international governing body of the Baha'i Faith. It operates from the World Center of the Baha'i Faith in the Haifa Akkar area, now in the State of Israel. The teachings and institutional foundations of the Baha'i Faith are derived from the writings of Baha'u'llah, Abdul Baha, and Shoghi Effendi. The Universal House of Justice is empowered to legislate on any areas that are not expressly covered in these texts. During the 150 years of its history, the Baha'i Faith has spread to all parts of the world. There are now Baha'i communities in every country, and Baha'i literature has been published in all major languages. One of the fascinating features of the Baha'i Faith is the way in which it has been successful in attracting large numbers of people from every conceivable background. In its country of origin, it attracted many thousands of Iranians from a Muslim background in both rural and urban areas. From there, it spread to North America, where large numbers of urban Christians became Baha'is. In South America, hundreds of thousands of Amerindian peasants from a Roman Catholic background have been converted. In India, over 2 million Hindu villages have become Baha'is. In Southeast Asia, large numbers of Buddhists have become Baha'is. In all, the Baha'i Faith is now regarded by authoritative independent sources as the second most widespread religion after Christianity. Only the Roman Catholic Church is more widespread. Some of the reasons for the fact that the Baha'i Faith has proved so attractive to such a wide array of humanity will, I hope, emerge from this audiobook. I have not attempted to provide a historical analysis of the way in which the Baha'i Faith, and in particular its administrative structure, has evolved historically. One of the main features of the Baha'i Faith is the rapid evolution that it has undergone. This has occurred within the framework laid down by its founder and his successors, and in response to changes in its situation and in world conditions. In the limited time available, all that I can do is to present a snapshot of the point to which the religion has evolved at the present time. Chapter 1. The Individual. Many people spend a great deal of time wondering about the meaning of their lives. Is there any purpose to my life? If there is a purpose, how can I discover it? And how can I fulfill that purpose? How can I achieve a lasting happiness and contentment? How can we be happy? At present, we are inundated with claims about what will make us happy and contented human beings. How often do we read in the newspapers that someone who claims to be an authority has asserted that if only we would do such and such a thing, we would be happy? How often do we see on the television an advertisement that claims that if only we would buy some product, we would be content? Examples of business executives, film stars, sports personalities, and pop stars are paraded in front of us as people who have made it, are successful, have everything that our society can offer, and are therefore presumably happy and content. Yet we know from those same newspapers, magazines, and television programs that so often the pictures presented to us of successful people hide loneliness, despair, and frustration. Power and wealth are presented to us as worthwhile goals, as a measure of a person's success and value to society. And yet at the same time, we know that those who attain these goals are often people who may have difficulty relating to others, who may be emotionally and spiritually impoverished, and are therefore unable to enjoy what they have achieved. Baha'u'llah's writings indicate that if we want happiness and contentment, we must do precisely the opposite to what we are constantly being urged to do by many of those around us. He advises us, "Dissipate not the wealth of your precious lives in the pursuit of evil and corrupt affection, nor let your endeavours be spent in promoting your personal interest." Referring to the illusion that wealth is, of itself, of any value to human happiness and development, Baha'u'llah says, "Thou dost wish for gold, and I desire thy freedom from it. Thou thinkest thyself rich in its possession, and I recognize thy wealth in thy sanctity therefrom. By my life, this is my knowledge, and that is thy fancy. How can my way accord with thine?" The futility of our quest for wealth. Abdul Baha cites the animals as an example of the futility of our quest for wealth and power. A bird on the summit of a mountain, on the high waving branches, has built for itself a nest more beautiful than the palaces of the kings. The air is in the utmost purity, the water cool and clear as crystal, the panorama charming and enchanting. In such glorious surroundings, he expends his numbered days. All the harvests of the plain are his possessions, having earned all this wealth without the least labour. Hence, no matter how much man may advance in this world, he shall not attain to the station of this bird. Thus it becomes evident that in the matters of this world, however much man may strive and work to the point of death, he will be unable to earn the abundance, the freedom, and the independent life of a small bird. This proves and establishes the fact that man is not created for the life of this ephemeral world. Nay, rather, he is created for the acquirement of infinite perfections, for the attainment to the sublimity of the world of humanity, to be drawn nigh unto the divine threshold, and to sit on the throne of everlasting sovereignty. Tablets of the Divine Plan. Our belief that we can gain happiness by accumulating wealth and power, or by indulging our sensual or material passions, is due to the fact that we have been deluded by the physical world that surrounds us. It seems so immediate and real that we think it is the most important thing. The pressing immediacy and vividness of this world are, however, veils hiding its emptiness. According to Baha'u'llah, the world is but a show, vain and empty, a mere nothing, bearing the semblance of reality. Set not your affections upon it. Verily I say, the world is like the vapour in a desert, which the thirsty dreameth to be water, and striveth after it with all his might, until when he cometh unto it, he findeth it to be mere illusion. Elsewhere in the Baha'i Scriptures, our life in this world is compared to a passing wave on the surface of the ocean, or a fleeting shadow. This world and all that it promises are with us for only a short time. We should not therefore grow attached to what will eventually fade and wither away. These few brief days shall pass away. This present life shall vanish from our sight. The roses of this world shall be fresh and fair no more. The garden of this earth's triumphs and delights shall droop and fade. The spring season of life shall turn into the autumn of death. The bright joy of palace halls give way to moonless dark within the tomb. And therefore is none of this worth loving at all. And to this the wise will not anchor his heart. Abdul Baha. It is the nature of this physical world to be full of pain and suffering. Such is this mortal abode, a storehouse of afflictions and suffering. It is ignorance that binds man to it, for no comfort can be secured by any soul in this world, from monarch down to the most humble commoner. If once this life should offer a man a sweet cup, 100 bitter ones will follow. Such is the condition of this world. Abdul Baha. We should try to change ourselves before the short time that we have on this earth comes to an end. Baha'u'llah urges us to cut ourselves free from the attractions of this world and the pursuit of selfish aims. O my servant, free thyself from the fetters of this world, and loose thy soul from the prison of self. Seize thy chance, for it will come to thee no more. The spiritual quest. If we are to find and understand the knowledge that leads to lasting happiness and contentment, we must search for it. Our search, however, must not be among the things of this world, which only lead to sadness and suffering. Rather, we must make our search a spiritual quest. Baha'u'llah has likened the search to a spiritual journey, and he has described the standard that must be achieved if the journey is to be successful. The true seeker and the search. But, O my brother, when a true seeker determineth to take the step of search in the path leading to the knowledge of the Ancient of Days, he must, before all else, cleanse and purify his heart from the obscuring dust of all acquired knowledge and the illusions of the embodiments of satanic fancy. He must purge his breast of every defilement and sanctify his soul from all that pertaineth to water and clay, from all shadowy and ephemeral attachments. He must so cleanse his heart that no remnant of either love or hate may linger therein, lest that love blindly incline him to error, or that hate repel him away from the truth. That seeker must at all times put his trust in God, must renounce the peoples of the earth, detach himself from the world of dust, and cleave unto him who is the Lord of Lords. He must never seek to exalt himself above anyone, must wash away from the tablet of his heart every trace of pride and vainglory, must cling unto patience and resignation, observe silence, and refrain from idle talk. That seeker should also regard backbiting as grievous error, and keep himself aloof from its dominion, inasmuch as backbiting quencheth the light of the heart and extinguisheth the life of the soul. He should be content with little.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.